sound system under control. Let's prepare our hearts to worship the Lord as we take some time in quiet meditation and prayer. Helps in the name of the Lord who created the heavens and the earth. Amen. We want to welcome everyone again to worship this morning. A couple of announcements that we need to make and also maybe clarify just a bit. Normally we have our congregational meeting the first Sunday in December. This year the first Sunday in December is Thanksgiving weekend and we did not want to do that. So we are going to be having our congregational meeting on the second Sunday, which is the 8th. Also, if you look at some places, it's going to say at 12 o'clock. Honestly, it should be more at 11 o'clock because we have changed our worship time. It will be following worship, which is now at 10. So around 11, we will be having our congregational meeting after worship on December the 8th. Just want to make sure everyone's clear on that. We are also taking up our annual or biannual denominational offering. This is the Thanksgiving offering. If you need an envelope or more information about that offering, there's information, I believe, available in the ambulatory. We also are taking up missions. This is our last Sunday of the month, so we take up a missions offering. A very important announcement. If you'll look in your bulletin, there's a white sheet. It talks about a candlelight Christmas celebration. We are changing some of our things that we have done on for Christmas. We are combining our music and our Christmas party into one. And so please make a note of this, that we are going, and there's an announcement in the bulletin that explains it further. So at 5 o'clock on December the 15th, we will start here in the sanctuary, and there will be a program of music. And then there will be a time of fellowship as we make our way down to the fellowship hall, and there we will have a candlelight dinner together as a congregation. It's very important because dinner is being served that we have a good number. So we want you to invite people. We want all of you to come, but we also want you to invite your friends and family to come, anyone who you want to invite. But we need to know they're coming, and we need to have them signed up. And the sign-up is going to be the cutoff date. The deadline is 12 o'clock on Monday, December the 9th. So please make a note of that. If you have questions, see one of us, officers, or Stacy. Andrea Henley's mom fell and is having surgery today at Piedmont, and we want to pray for her. Lathan Rivers' dad is very low, and I talked to Lathan just a few moments ago, texted with him, and he appreciates prayers. We need to pray for Lathan and his dad and family, especially, he said, his mom, who's having a very difficult time. Mr. David is very low. Ethan is not here this morning. He is sick, but he is also preaching at Heath Springs Baptist. So let's pray for him that he would be able to endure that and get through it, and that he would have power to preach. Also, Aaron Morrison's girlfriend, Katie Harmon, who comes a good bit, she texted me this morning. Her stepfather was rushed to the ER this morning, and so we want to pray for her. So we have a lot of announcements here that we normally don't have about a special prayer item, so we want to remember these things in prayer. A couple of other additional information. We're going to be having a ginger house building time for our children on December the 4th, and there's going to be a caroling and dinner. Those who want to, basically, those who want to go caroling on Wednesday the 11th, and then we're going to have like a soup dinner afterwards. So if you're interested in that, you can get more information from Stacy or from me. Please make a note of the other announcements in the bulletin and on the website. And as we prepare our hearts, let us stand now and sing our Congregational Introit, Open Our Eyes. Let's stand. Comes from Psalm 100. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Let us now sing our thanks to God as we take our Red Trinity hymnal and turn to number 98. Now thank we all our God, number 98. Let us pray together. Great God in heaven, we come before you and we give thanks. We all come and give thanks to you, our God, who has given us all things, the God who receives our praise when we are overjoyed, the God who calms our fears when we cry out in fear. For you are a God whose steadfast love truly endures forever. For you are with us, whether we are in the highs of life or the lows of life, or even the everyday of life, we come and we give thanks to you, for we see that all we have, our very existence, is rooted in you as our Creator, and that all the blessings and good things that we have enjoyed in this world come from your providential hand. Father, we come to you today on this, your day, the day set aside for your worship, and we lift up our praise and our worship. We come especially giving thanks as we join with the world in thanksgiving. And Father, I pray that you would help our thanksgiving not be a generic, but but rather a very focused thanks to you, the living God, acknowledging all things coming from your hand and seeking your face, our God, our Father. We come and we worship you today. As we come, Father, we come using the words that Christ used in teaching his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And give praise to you that we're able to come now and worship you through the giving of our tithes and offerings. How you have blessed us. How you have given us more than we can ever truly imagine. We are thankful for our salvation. We are thankful for your grace. We are thankful for your provision. We are thankful that our cup overflows. And though some may be poor in this world, all of us who know Christ are rich in him. And we come now and we give in obedience. And we come giving praise to you and trust in you, knowing that our hope and our help comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. It comes from the one who created heavens and earth, and the one in whose presence we are now. For we come in Christ's name and we worship through our giving. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. This week we're going to be using the Nicene Creed as our confession of faith. We do this on the last Sunday of every month. The Nicene Creed is a little different than the Apostle Creed. It's a little longer for the first point, but it also really addresses in a lot of ways who Christ is and goes into more detail. So it's good for us to use this. So as we gather together to worship, as we gather together in the name of Christ, Christians, I ask you, in whom do you believe? We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, whom for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. If you remain standing, take your blue ARP Psalter. We'll sing Psalm 44, Selection A. O God, we have heard of your works. 44A. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Samuel 27. We'll be looking there for our Old Testament reading. 1 Samuel 27, verses 8 through 12. This is found on page 250 of your pew Bibles, 250, 1 Samuel 27, 8 through 12. Let us hear and read God's word together. Now David and his men went up and made raids against the Gershites, the Gerzites, and the Amalekites. Hebrew was very fun for me, I want to tell you that. For these were the inhabitants of the land from the of old, as far as Shur, to the land of Egypt. And David would strike the land and would leave neither man nor woman alive, but would take away the sheep, oxen, the donkey, the camels, and the garments, and come back to Achish. When Achish asked, "Where have you made a raid today?" David would say, "Against Negev of Judah, or against Negev of the Jerahmeelites, against Negev of the Kenites." And David would leave neither man nor woman alive to bring news to Gath, thinking lest they should tell us and say, "So David has done." Such was his custom all while he lived in the country of the Philistines. And Achish trusted David, thinking, "He has made himself such an utter stench to his people Israel. Therefore he shall always be my servant." The reading of God's word. Let us come together before the throne of grace, and let us lift up our prayers this morning. Father God, we come before your great throne, and we come with thanksgiving. We are thankful that you have revealed yourself to us, that we are not at a loss as to who you are, for you have made your ways, your character, your attributes abundantly clear in your word. Not only have you given these things to us in theory, but you have given them to us in practice. As we see your interaction with your people, both in your word and through the history of the church, and even in our own experience walking with you, we have found you to be who you have said you are, a God of perfect attributes, a God of all strength and power and knowledge, a God in whom we can put our faith and trust both for this world and the everlasting world. So we come and we give praise to you for who you are, and we are thankful that we can see and know the one true and living God. Father, as we approach you, as the light of your face shines upon us, we see our sin. We see how small we truly are, how insignificant. But yet, our significance is not in our size. It is not in our ability. It is not in us at all. The great significance of our life is that we have been loved by an almighty God, that he has poured out his grace and mercy upon us, that he has given us his own Son, Jesus Christ. He has risen us up from the swallower of our sin, that we might be the sons and the daughters of the living God. Our hearts are thankful this morning for the change in our position through the grace that is only found in you and by the gospel that transforms us and brings us before our God and into his very family. Father, we thank you. We come confessing our sin, confessing our unworthiness, confessing our hopelessness, and grabbing hold of the gospel and moving forward, clinging tightly to our one true hope. Father, we come and we give thanks. We give thanks for the world around us. We give thanks for families. We join the world as they give thanks. For family, for health, for success in this world, for the blessings that you've given to us and our children, to our friends, to our nation. We are a blessed people in the things of this world, just like those outside of Christ. But we also come, that we see that these are not just random assignments. This is not just fate. This is not fortune. It is the providence of God, and we trust in that providence, and we come and give thanks to all the provisions you've given to us, and we know that we have been blessed beyond measure. We give praise to you for your answered prayer, for the relationship that is ours as a people saved by grace. How dim the gold of this world is when compared to the brightness of knowing our God and being counted as a child of the living God. Father, we come this morning and our hearts are heavy as we have several urgent prayer requests. We pray, Father, for Andrea Henley and her family with her mother having surgery this afternoon. Remember the Rivers family. Remember especially Lathan's mom, as his dad is very low, and we just lift them up to you. Father, we come, we pray for Katie Harmon's dad, who was taken to the ER this morning. Father, we come and we pray for those who are wrestling with grief. A year ago, we lost two of our members in the same week. And Father, how fresh that wound still is with us, and how we miss them. Father, there's many, as we enter the Thanksgiving and Christmas season, that we feel that loss of loved ones. It stings a little more as we gather together with families, as we celebrate the season, as we think about our loss. Father, we pray that you would pour out your power, your healing, your grace, and your peace upon those who grieve. Father, we pray for those who are going to be having tests this week. We pray, Father, for those who are dealing with chronic and long-term illnesses. Father, we have those who have changes of life coming. We pray that you would be with them. Father, we pray for our church. We pray for the sheep of this flock, that you would care for each of them in all of their needs. Father, we come and we pray for our government. And Father, we have prayed often for our government. And as our government seems more and more divided, we pray that you would work through those that you have put upon, over us. Give us wisdom as we approach an election next year. But Father, as we have sung in the psalm this morning, our hope is not in the sword. Our hope is not in the powers of this world. We as Christians, our hope is not in the Republican Party or the Democratic Party or the Libertarian Party or any party of men. But rather, our hope is in our God, in King Jesus. Here is where we put our hope, and here is where we lift our prayers, that you might bring order to this world, that justice might flow down from your throne and be known in this world, that we might see peace, and that you might bring harmony among nations and among men. Father, we lift this up to you. Father, we pray for the ministries of our church. We pray that you would bless our choir. We are thankful for their hard work as they have a new chapter in their history. Father, we thank you for the opportunities we have to socialize and to fellowship and to sing and to pray in the next month. And Father, we pray that you would be the center of all that we do. Father, we pray for the lost. We pray that you would help us to engage the lost, that we would overcome our fear, our timidness, that we would have such a vision for what we have gained in Christ, that we could not help but tell others about what Christ has done for us. May we have a burden to know that if our friends, our family members, those that we meet, if they do not know Christ, they are lost to an eternal hell. Oh, Father, open our hearts that we might in love and joy share the gospel. With concern, we might share the gospel. And that as we share the gospel, you might work in the hearts of men and women and boys and girls, that you might do what you've done in our hearts and draw them to yourself. Father, bless our efforts as we reach out. Build up your saints as we come and as we preach and as we teach, as we fellowship together. Build each other up. Hold us together through your word and lead us by your Spirit. And grow us more and more each and every day. Father, we come this day to worship. We come this day especially giving thanks. And may you receive our thanks as we give it from the bottom of our hearts in joy and in response to your gospel love. For we come in Christ's name and we pray it. Amen. Choir, you are dismissed. If the children would come down. I think I saw children. There she is. She's not sitting with y'all. Good morning. How are you guys? Good. So, what is Thursday? Thanksgiving. What's important about Thursday? Be thankful. Okay. So what are some things y'all are thankful about this year? You're thankful for your family. Your dogs. I'm glad someone in our family is thankful for the dogs. So you've started fourth grade. She's getting old. Fourth grade. Well, as we think about Thanksgiving, where do we as Christians especially, where should we focus our thanks? God. Why do we focus it to God? He created us. He's the creator of all things. I'm hearing catechism here. He's our creator. What else does he do? Did he just create the world and step back and walk away? What does he do? He made it perfect originally, and then sin came in. But he still rules the world by his providence, right? That's the catechism, if you didn't know it, guys. Okay? So as we gather together, we don't just give thanks. We just don't say thanks like the world says thanks. We give thanks to God. And it's not just at Thanksgiving, is it? What are we doing here this morning? We're worshiping God, and part of our worship of God should be what? Telling him what? Thank you, that's right. I tell you what, I can tell you in the fourth grade, you had some good answers. All right, let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you for these little ones. I thank you for their understanding of where blessings come from, that you are a God who created us and a God who rules this world by your providential power. And we know all blessings come from you, and if all blessings come from you, we come and we give thanks to you. And I pray that these young ladies would grow in their knowledge of who you are, that they would grow in their thanksgiving to God, to you, for all that you have done. May it be a mark of their life, and may it show them different from the world in which they live. Bless them, we pray now in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 105. Psalm 105, as we think about Thanksgiving, as we think about our lives together, and we think about our life that we live in this world, and as we hopefully are thinking about the thanks that we have and the reasons to be thankful, we come and we look at a psalm of thanks that deals with our God and the people of God giving thanks to Him. Before we read Psalm 105, let's pray again. Father in heaven, we come before you today, and we are thankful that you have given us your word. We are thankful that you are a living God who has not just made the world and walked away. You're not an observing God, but that you're an interacting God. That you meet with your people. That you hear our prayers. That you work in us and through us and all around us. And Father, as we come to worship and we see and acknowledge your work, your salvation, your providence, your creation, we come and we give thanks to you for all that you have given to us. Father, help us to be a thankful people. Father, help us now as we see your word to be encouraged and spurred on in our thanks. Bless this time. Give words to your servant and ears to your people. Open our hearts and bless us through Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. Psalm 105, we'll be reading verses 1 through 6. Let us hear God's word together. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered, O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen ones. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord endures forever. Amen. You are called to be different from the world. We as Christians are called to be different. Now, as you think about that, there's a couple ways we can approach that. You can try to make an external difference by the way you dress. You know, we could have a dress code, right? You know, you go to Rucker, and you can identify Rucker students, right? At 3 o'clock in the afternoon or between 3 and 5 in the afternoon, you see a kid running through Walmart or at the fast food place, and you see him with a certain outfit on, you go, that child goes to Rucker. I guess. Does South have the same outfits? I don't think they do. That messes up my illustration if they do, so let's say they don't. So you can see, but is that what it means that we're to be different from the world, that we're to dress different? Now, we maybe should dress a little different, but are we to be known by our dress, by our quote-unquote uniform? No. Maybe we should wear a badge. Maybe that would set us apart. Maybe if we wore a big cross. Maybe if we had a necklace for the ladies and a little lapel pin for all us men who wear suits every day, right? But is that really what it means to be different from the world? An external difference? I think the answer is no. There should be something that contrasts us from the world around us. And this should contrast us not just from the what we call, like I like to call, the beady-eyed heathens of the world, but we as a Christian people should be different even from our quote-unquote good neighbors and friends who are outside of Christ. Christ should be making a difference in who we are that should show itself when we are compared to the world. And I would argue that we have a great opportunity this week to show a clear difference between Christians and the world. Now, you might be thinking Thanksgiving would be a time that we're actually, the world is going to be a lot more like us. The world is coming and giving thanks, and we as Christians give thanks, and thus we would be more like the world this week. But think about how the world celebrates Thanksgiving. First of all, how many of them call it Turkey Day? Hopefully y'all don't call it Turkey Day unless you're just having fun. It's Thanksgiving. And they do often pause to vocalize the things that they are thankful for in their life. The bedrock of their thanks, though, is what? It is family. It is home. It is security. It is worldly blessings, health. And we can see these pictures over and over again as we see television and movies where people will go around the table and say what they're thankful for this year. Sometimes the sitcoms can make that real funny. For a Christian, our thanks is not just something we vocalize into the air or to our friends or to others. It is something that we lift up to the Lord, who is the object of our thanks and our praise. You see, we have not been blessed by fate or by chance or by fortune. God has poured out his blessings upon us Christians who are his children. I ask you, when you sang and thanked God, was your focus on God? There is so much noise in our world. There's so much noise in my house. I don't know how your house is. But if it isn't the children, it's the dogs. And if it's not the dogs, it's the phone. And if it's not any of that, it's a car going up and down the road. Noise-canceling headphones. This is how we can survive. But as we come into church, there's often noise of our life. We are so busy and we are so much stimulated that we come here, and honestly, this is one of the most unstimulating places that we come to. Let me explain. You hear that? That's quiet. I can hear the heater running, right? How often do you have that in your life? And so if we sit here in quiet, how quickly that vacuum, the world wants to come rushing in. It comes rushing in as we sing. And so while our lips are moving, is our mind engaged with the words? Are our hearts engaged lifting up the praise of God? I ask you, when we sang, was your focus on God? When we prayed with thanksgiving, was your focus on giving thanks to God, the source of all our blessings? Here is a key difference between Christians and the world. The world appreciates and encourages the idea of thanksgiving, but the Christian life is built on thanksgiving to God for all things. We see this in Psalm 105. This is a psalm of David, and we see it first given in 1 Chronicles 6 when the Ark of the Covenant is brought into the tent in Jerusalem by David, and this psalm is written and is to be sung before the Ark. Song of thanksgiving, a song of praise. So our teaching this morning is that Christians, you are called to be thankful by calling on God, declaring all that he has done, worshiping him, and seeking him. Let's look at Psalm 105. The first thing we see is that we are called to be a thankful people. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. We are called to give thanks to Jehovah, to the Lord. Christians, you are called to give thanks. Why is this? Where is the basis? Is this about, what is it? There's so many things that we can give thanks to God for. Where does this start? What is the root of it? What is the foundation of thanks by Christians to God? It's the salvation that we have. This psalm alludes to the Exodus several places. Calvin talks about in his commentaries, the allusion to Exodus and the salvation that had been wrought by God for the Hebrew people. Now think about this. When were they doing this? This wasn't while they were wandering around in the desert. It wasn't even when they crossed over into the Promised Land. David is tying the ark, the presence of God, coming into the tent at Jerusalem, and reminding them of all that God had promised and all that God had done, and it was to be a psalm of thanksgiving, remembering who God is. Christians, we are called to be thankful for the salvation that is ours. In the Old Testament, the Exodus was the great saving event. But we have a greater one. We have the cross. We have the empty tomb. And we come together, and we are to be a thankful people because we have been saved by the love of God through the Son of God. And this psalm, though a reminder for the Hebrews of all the promises and fulfillments of those promises, it still calls us to remember who God is and what He has done for us. That He has saved us by His grace. But not only saved us, there's also a sense of adoption here. That the Hebrew people had become God's people, God's children. You see that in verse 6. O offspring of Abraham, his servant, children of Jacob, his chosen one. We see that in our salvation as Christians, that we are now adopted into God's family. We are called the sons and the daughters of the living God. Excuse me. This is the core of Christian thanksgiving. God has made us His people. This is the bedrock of our thanksgiving. You know, if you're building a house, isn't it great if you can get to the bedrock? If you can get to the thing that's not going to move. You know it is solid. And it's not going anywhere. Here is the bedrock of our thanksgiving. It what drives our thanks. It's not the superficial things of the world. Think about those things in the world. Think about your blessings that you have right now. We are all blessed. We live like kings, most of us. We have nice cars. We have a decent house. We wear nice clothes. But what if all that was taken away? Could you still have Thanksgiving? What if you had to have Spam instead of turkey on Thursday? Would you still be thankful? You see, for the Christian, these are just, as we say, the cherries on top, the blessings of this world. But though we find ourselves in a horrible situation, yet we as Christians have this bedrock of thanks. We have our salvation. We have what God has done for a poor sinner like us. And this allows Christians to give thanks in any situation, famine, poverty, sickness, loss, even oppression. The Christian always has reasons for thanksgiving. Now, is this because we're a bunch of crazy zealots? No, we have seen God's salvation. We know that we are saved by Christ's blood and death. We know the price God has paid for us. And we are loved of God and even made a part of His own family. Sons and daughters of the true God. And this is the foundation that can never be taken away from the Christian. Remembering this is key to our thanks to God. Charles Spurgeon, the great English Baptist pastor, he used to say he preached the gospel often, constantly. And he said, if you're a Christian, you should never tire of hearing the gospel, of remembering what God has done for you. Salvation is the foundation of our thanks. Salvation is what makes us a thankful people. Give thanks to Him. How are you to give thanks to God? What are the means of giving thanks? I think we see that somewhat in the next following verses. You're to call upon His name. Call upon the name of God. Call for help. Call on Him to be your God and to help you in your need. How is that giving thanks? The great commentary written by Matthew Henry, he says, praying for further mercies is accepted as an acknowledgement of former mercies. The Christian knows where his help has been. And where his help is even now. I remember Thanksgiving as I got older, my papa and I used to go to Edisto, and we would go fishing and shrimping down there at Thanksgiving. I'm not sure how we got away from the family to do that, but we did not ask a question. Now, we used to go fishing, and sometimes we wouldn't catch a thing. But there was one spot that we could always go that my grandfather knew we would catch a fish at the certain time of the day, at a certain time of the tide. Now, that involved a great deal of walking through a marsh, but it was there. And if he hadn't caught any fish, he'd make the effort to go because there he knew more than likely he would catch fish. There was that one place. Christians, you should know that there's this one place that is always our help. That is our God. And we're to call on his name. Call on it each week, each day, and at every moment of need. This acknowledges who he is and what he has done and gives thanks to him and shows forth our true heart of trust in him. We're to remember his works. Call on, it says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known his deeds among the people. Verse 2, tell of his wondrous works. Verse 5, remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he utters. We remember his works. This is why we set aside days. We need days to remember. We have Memorial Day in May, and that is a day that we remember those who died in service to our country. We just had Veterans Day, a day in which we remember those and we thank those who served our country in the military. It's why we have Thanksgiving, to remember that God has blessed us. Thanksgiving was tied to the harvest. Now, the Puritans, who are some of our forefathers, they did not like holy days. They did not like Christmas. There's a big joke on the internet for those of us who follow these things. Banner of Truth has a big Christmas Puritan sale, which the Puritans would not be happy about, a Puritan Christmas sale. But one thing the Puritans really did buy into, and I agree with them, is they would call for days of fasting at difficulties and also days of thanksgiving when there was reason for rejoicing and praising God. A lot of the reason Thanksgiving comes when it does is that it is tied back into the idea of the harvest, that this was the end of the year. Now, depending where you are on the East Coast, how far up, you know, harvest in New England happened a long time ago in this year, right? And if you go down to Florida, they're still harvesting. So it depends, right? But generally, in the fall, it is determined that this is the harvest time. We all know that. And so this is a day that was set aside. It was codified in our law to be a national day of thanksgiving. For the church, it is a day to give thanks to God. For the world, it's a family day, a turkey day, a day for football. And unfortunately, more and more, it kicks off Christmas, although it is being eaten up even now as we have one less week between Thanksgiving and Christmas. Black Friday sales started last Friday. For us as Christians, we are called to remember the things God has blessed you with this year. That is the purpose of the day. We also sing here that we are to not only remember, to call on the Lord and remember the Lord, we're to sing praises. We're to sing to God his praises. Think about the importance of songs. Songs teach us the truth of who God is. It helps us express. If you ever have a cold heart, if you're ever having trouble praying, get a hymnal. Look up a hymn online. Look up a psalm and sing it, if it doesn't jumpstart your praise and your prayer. The hymn book is a book of praise and remembrance. The Psalter even more so. If you are thankful, then you will want to sing to God his praise and declare what he has done. Finally, we see in verse 3, we're to glory in his holy name. What does it mean to glory? Some glory in their achievements. Some glory in their children. Some glory in their abilities. But Christian, you are called to glory in the name of your God, in who he is and what he has done. Are you intentional to give thanks to God? Does your heart warm in worship as you sing, as you pray? Do you know that rock that bedrock, and you call on Him in thanks. Where's your glory? Where's the glory of your life? Is it in something of this world? Or is it in the God who has given you all things that you wish to glorify Him with all that you have? The final thing that we see here is that thanks should make us seek God, to follow God. Verse 4, seek the Lord and His strength. Seek His presence continually. If you are truly thankful, it changes us from the inside out. Seek God's presence is to worship Him. Now, we Presbyterians can turn worship into a lecture in a heartbeat. And we have to be very careful of that. We need to draw close to God and seek after Him with not only our minds, but our hearts as well. We need to bow down our hearts and open our minds and seek Him. Seeking to praise Him, seeking to declare His works, seeking to follow Him with our whole lives. You know, when a young man becomes smitten with a young lady, he seeks to know as much as he can about that young lady. He wants to know what she likes, what type of music she likes, what type of food she likes, what kind of movies she likes. Desires to know as much as possible. So should we who have been loved by God seek to know as much as we can about our God, about His Son Jesus Christ, about the salvation that has been given to us, about His Word given for our good. Often we are too pragmatic, especially as American Christians. We just want to get to heaven. How do we do that? It's not about the end. It's about knowing and being known by the living God. Seeking Him and worshiping Him. We need to seek His will. We need to be centered on His Word. Thanks should lead to obedience, not in fear, but in love and trust. How many of us remember the old hymn, Trust and Obey? Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. If we love Christ, and we're thankful for the cross, and we're thankful for the empty tomb, and we're thankful for new life, and we're thankful for the blessings of the new life, then we should also be thankful for His Word, for all the commands entailed and contained in the Word. And we should be seeking to know it, and we should be seeking to follow it. And then finally, we also need to be seeking His help through His power. Thanks gives praise to where we know our hope comes from. Only a fool would know where to find perfect and free help and not reach out and take it. We build on a foundation of thanks that is rooted again in salvation and adoption. We know what God has done for us. The Hebrews knew. They knew the story of the Red Sea, how it parted and how it closed up upon the Egyptians, of how manna fell from heaven, of how the quail was provided, of how God had taken care of them, how the walls of Jericho had fallen down. They knew the victories that had led to this moment where the ark is led into the tent at Jerusalem. They remember who their God was. They remember who they were in their God. And they are now giving thanks, and so should we, a people who know that Christ came, lived, and died, and rose again, that we might be saved, that we might be the children of God, that we might be in a relationship with God, renewed, new creations. We know what God has done, and we know He has said, ask, seek, and knock. He knows that He is jealous for us with a Father's love, and He wishes to pour out good gifts upon us if we will follow Him and if we will cry out and help and seek Him, that He is our help for every day. And we should seek God's help. So we come to Thanksgiving. As I said before, the rhythms of our lives have changed. The harvest is no longer the central focus to most of us. I don't know. I know a couple people here who garden or have a small farm, but most of us, you know, our harvest is usually done at Food Line, right? And we usually go on every Thursday or Saturday or whatever day you go, or maybe it's multiple times, and you harvest it into the grocery cart and you go. Gone are those days of the putting up of the harvest, of seeing the storehouses full with a bumper crop and being able to come and thank God for his clear provision. We're drowning in blessings, are we not? I read a story about the communist and about how often communists who would defect would be brought to the U.S. and they would take them to an average grocery store or to a butcher shop. And they would say, "You're lying to me." And the people would be like, "What are you talking about?" And they said, "There's not that much meat in all of Russia. This is a stage thing." How little they had. How little provision they had coming from that communist nation. Do we realize how blessed we are? Or do we long for things that we don't have? As we put our eyes upon the things of this world, how easy it is to forget the things that we have as Christians. This bedrock of things. Let us not drown in our abundance, but let us swipe that away for a while and let us see our true hope, our true blessing, which comes from the Lord. I challenge you as Christians, where is your Thanksgiving focused? Not just in the yearly celebration, but at the Thanksgiving of your heart. Is it rooted in God? Are you a thankful person to God? Psalm 105 calls us to remember and thank God. Are you remembering your salvation? But moreover, are you remembering the goodness of the things that God has given to you? The older I get, the more I can add to my story. As I can see God's intervention, God's mercy, God's protection. Are we sharing that with our children? With those that maybe don't have the lifespan we've had to trust God? Maybe those who've just professed faith? How are we talking about how God has been the rock of your life? They can read the Bible. They can know what God has done for his people in the Bible. Have you shared your life, your Thanksgiving? This is one of the things we try to do on Sunday nights as we get around and as we gather and talk about Christ and about God, about the Bible, and about how all that comes together. Do your children know why you're thankful to God for the things in your life? I encourage you, consider your Thanksgiving. Is it a foundation of your life in Christ? Is your glory, is the glory of your life to live for the Lord Jesus Christ with thanksgiving, remembering who he is and there being your trust? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we come today and we thank you. We thank you that you've set aside in this world a day of thanksgiving. In our world, many, many nations around the world have days of thanksgiving, but for us it is this Thursday. And we pray that we would engage that as a Christian people. Help us to give thanks off the foundation of our salvation. And may it be a mark not only of one day a year, but every day. May it be a source of our security. May it be a source of our hope. May it just overflow in us the more we see who our God is and what he has done and how we can depend upon him and he knows. never fails us. May we respond with thanks in our songs, in our prayers, in our whole life. May it be lived with thanksgiving to God. For we pray it in Christ's name. Amen. So we come now, we'll take our Red Trinity hymnal. And we'll sing 715, which is a good Thanksgiving song. This is an opportunity for you right now to give thanks to God, to open your mouth and to sing His praise in obedience to His word, but more importantly, out of a heart full of thanks. Let's stand and sing number 715, Come Ye Thankful People Come, 715. Today we offer to you the gospel that's been preached, that Christ came and died and rose again, that we might be thankful, that we might be saved, and that we might have overflowing thanksgiving for that great salvation. If you do not know that salvation, come and talk with myself or one of the elders and know the Lord. Believe in Him as He's offered freely to you. Now receive the benediction of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen.